Hey folks, this video is about a statement by Dr. Bart Ehrman. Dr. Bart Ehrman is an agnostic. He is a Bible scholar, considered one of the best Bible scholars of our time. I'm not so sure that's true, but there are a number of other scholars who cite him as being a good Bible scholar. He does not believe the Bible, though. He does not believe Jesus Christ is God manifest in the flesh, doesn't believe in Christianity, seems to be extremely opposed to it. I want to point out something about Dr. Bart Ehrman. He seems to do a double take a lot. He has two faces. He'll say something that seems to support the Christian when he's talking to Christians, to an uninformed, uneducated general public. But when he's talking to other scholars, he seems to have a different opinion. He wishy-washes, he flip-flops back and forth. I think this is because, and many people have noticed it, it's because he thinks he can get away with doing that when he's talking to an uneducated general public, as opposed to when he's talking to other Bible scholars who are going to see past what he's doing. For example, he says this in his book, Misquoting Jesus. Bruce Metzger is one of the great scholars of modern times, and I dedicated my book to him because he was both my inspiration for going into textual criticism and the person who trained me in the field. I have nothing but respect and admiration for him, and even though we may disagree on important religious issues, he is a confirmed Christian, committed Christian, and I am not, we are in complete agreement on a number of very important historical and textual questions. If he and I were put into a room and asked to hammer out a consensus statement on what we think the original text of the New Testament probably looked like, there would be very few points of disagreement, maybe one or two dozen places out of many thousands. The position I argue for in Misquoting Jesus does not actually stand at odds with Professor Metzger's position that the essential Christian beliefs are not affected by textual variants in the manuscript tradition of the New Testament. So essentially what he's saying is, in this passage, he's saying that we can essentially trust that the Bible that we have today is in fact what the apostles wrote, because it's been accurately copied and passed down from the centuries. And that we can trust what Jesus said was actually said by Jesus because of that very same fact. Now, so he'll make this blatant admission in a book intended for the general, for other scholars. But when he speaks to the general public in debates or when he does his lecturing thing, he gives a completely different view. He comes across as somebody who's saying, we can't possibly know what any of the things Jesus actually said were. The Bible has been so screwed up with textual variants, that is, changed willy-nilly so much that we can't really trust that Jesus said any of the things that are in it. That's a complete two-faced way of dealing with things. You see, he says one thing dealing with other scholars because he knows he can't get away with misrepresenting the Bible there. But when he speaks to the general public, he intentionally misrepresents the accuracy of the texts, which was extremely high, and textual variants, those that do exist, have no bearing on the validity of the text. They don't change anything that's important in it, and that we have no reason to doubt anything that's in the Bible today as being original because of textual variants, with the exception of two or three little parts. So, essentially, the Bible we have today is what was penned by the apostles, with two or three little variant, maybe a couple of important differences, but none of it affects Bible Christian doctrine, and none of it affects anything said by Jesus that makes any difference towards Christian doctrine. He'll say that when he talks to scholars, but if he was talking to the general public, he intentionally presents a completely different view. He has said a number of times in debates that we can't trust any of the things that are in the Bible as being actually said by Jesus Christ because the Bible's so willy-nilly been changed. So he does a complete about-face. He is two-faced, very two-faced. You can't trust what somebody like him says about the Bible. And so now I'm going to show you a little snippet of a video, a debate, between him and another Bible scholar, in which this Bible scholar calls him out for doing this two-faced flip-flop. He's going to call him out for it right before your own eyes.
But the way you're saying, see, you're trying to set up a straw man and say, unless I see him say, I am God, he didn't claim to be God. Let's go back to the Son of Man.
Why doesn't he say any of these things in the synoptics?
Let's go back to the Son of Man. Hey, great, great transition point. So you agree that the Son of Man figure is the highest, most exalted figure in Second Temple Judaism that's closest to God Almighty himself. You see?
No, before I can show the rest of this, let me point out what they're talking about. In the Bible, many times Jesus said that he was the Son of Man. And this statement is one of the numerous times that Jesus acknowledged that he was God manifest in the flesh. For Jesus to say that he is the Son of Man is to say that he is God who became a man. He calls himself the Son of Man to differentiate between what he was before he became man and what he is now standing before you in flesh of man. See, he calls himself the Son of Man because he was once not man. He was once God who had become a man. That's the reason Jesus calls himself the Son of Man. When Jesus calls himself the Son of Man, he is essentially saying, I am God in the flesh. God who was born into his own creation in the flesh of a man. That's what they're talking about here.
You said that in your recent book. So if Jesus claimed to be that Son of Man.
That's a little extreme. I wouldn't quite put it that way. That's putting a lot of weight on the Son of Man.
You wouldn't put it the way you put it?
What chapter are you quoting?
I quoted my presentation.
So there we have it. You see what has happened is this scholar here on the right has made a note that Bart Ehrman has said in the past that Jesus' statements that he is the Son of Man is the highest form kingship, you might say, or authority ever put forth in Judeo-Christianity by any Hebrew person. It is Jesus' highest claim to authority. It is his saying, essentially, that he is above all the prophets, above all inspired people that might be found in Scripture. This statement of Jesus, that he is the Son of Man, puts him above everyone else in all of Judaism and throughout the Bible's history. So it's a very powerful statement of Jesus' divinity. And this gentleman calls Bart Ehrman out on that because Bart Ehrman has said that this statement does that very thing for Jesus. It sets him up above anybody else in all of the Old Testament as being the closest one could possibly be to God for Jesus to say that he is the Son of Man. And this scholar pointed that out. But Bart Ehrman says, no, I really wouldn't put it quite that way. And then this scholar says, but wait a minute, that's how you put it. He says, really? I put it that way? And then he says, yeah. And he's digging up on his computer. So, yep, I quoted you in my opening statement. See, this is Bart Ehrman doing another flip-flop. Backtracking. Oh, wait, when did I say that? I didn't really say that. See? Because he's now in front of an uninformed, uneducated public. And when I say that, I mean, he's not talking with Bible scholars here. The public are lay people. The audience is likely mostly laypersons who come to see this debate. But if Bart Ehrman were talking about this subject in one of his books intended for other scholars to read, he would be representing these things in a very different way. So when this scholar on the right points out that Bart Ehrman has made that statement about Jesus' statement that he is the Son of Man, and then Bart Ehrman does a double track. Oh, what? When did I? I didn't really do, what? I didn't really do that, did I? I didn't really say it's quite like that. I wouldn't quite put it like that. Well, wait a minute. That's exactly how you put it in your book. I'm going to quote it for you. You see, Bart Ehrman is known for doing this kind of thing. He has one face that he presents to scholars, but when talking to what he thinks is an uninformed, uneducated layperson public, he loves to misrepresent the Bible and say that we can't trust anything in it that was ever said by Jesus. Or Jesus never made a claim to being God, all that kind of thing. And then he'll say a very different kind of thing in his books. That's very disingenuous. It demonstrates something interesting about Dr. Bart Ehrman, though. He's very much opposed to the truth of Christianity. He's not somebody who's just in it for the knowledge to learn and study and to become interested and authoritative on a particular subject. He's in it because he wants to learn all the excuses he can possibly dig up for himself for denying that Jesus is who he said he was. Let me play that little snippet again, because I find it almost laughable.
Closest to God Almighty himself. You said that in your recent book. So sure. If Jesus claimed that Son of Man.
That's a little extreme. I wouldn't quite put it that way. That's putting a lot of weight on the Son of Man.
You wouldn't put it the way you put it?
What chapter are you quoting?
I quoted my presentation.
There it is. So he does his flip-flops because Bart Ehrman likes to say one thing when dealing with scholars and completely represent the Bible in a disingenuous way when talking to the public. Because his real motivation is to slander the Bible so that you won't believe it. It's just, it's truly sad. Just thought I'd point that out. Be careful who you listen to and what they say. Don't believe everything you hear. Study to show thyself approved. God bless.